I am Dr. Lalith Lienage, IET Sri Lanka Network Chairman. Today we have a very interesting subject to discuss and very eminent speaker, Engineer Sanath Panavanage, Director General and Chief Executive Officer of Arthur C. Clarke Institute for Modern Technologies, Katubaddha Moratuwa. The topic you have already seen, acquisition of national capacity in space technologies and applications and imperative for development. Sri Lanka has taken few advanced steps in space technologies thanks to Arthur C. Clarke Center, and Sanath will be talking all these things today. Let me just brief on his synopsis. The term space technology refers to an ensemble of technologies that are used in the exploration and use of outer space, the range of technologies involved in the development, launch, and operation of artificial satellites and space shuttles, whilst serving the scientifically exciting human endeavor of space exploration. On the one hand, space technology has more importantly enabled exploiting of the vantage point of outer space for the more down-to-earth, nevertheless more enterprising realm of space technology applications, where the activity can be identified in three distinct domains, namely satellite communication systems, atmospheric and earth observation satellite systems, and global navigation and positioning satellite systems. So he will be elaborating on this. Space technologies and their applications, once the domain of a few technologically advanced nations, has now become a domain of increasing techno-economic and social-political interest in national development amongst both developed and developing nations. Today, space technologies have found applications in all conceivable facets of human activity, spanning the domains including weather forecasting and climate change mitigation, monitoring and protection of natural environmental ecosystems, including air, water, soil, oceans, forests and glaciers, natural resources management, surveying, urban development, surface transportation, maritime and air navigation, telecommunications, agriculture, industry and commerce, and disaster risk reduction. In fact, globally adopted development agenda such as Sustainable Development Goals 2030, Sendai Framework on Disaster Risk Reduction, and the Paris Agreement on Climate Action have all accorded high emphasis on to harnessing of the potential of space technology and applications. While Sri Lanka has already embarked upon some significant programs toward development of its national capabilities in space technologies and applications, sustained long-term development of national space capabilities as well as realization of its optimal benefits through comprehensive socio-economic integration essentially requires policy coherence across development of technology capacity and applications, stronger institutional structures and processes, and greater emphasis on resource mobilization. So when we talk about Arthur C. Clarke Institute, we can't forget about the great Arthur C. Clarke, who was a foreigner. He preferred living in Sri Lanka and contributed to the world of space technologies immensely through his imaginary literature, space technology related literature. Now let me introduce our speaker. First of all, I'm thankful to Sanath for accepting my invitation and taking over this webinar for the interest of our engineers. Actually, Sanath has been a member of our main committee, IET main committee, for several years and has contributed a lot for our activities for during past years. As I said, Engineer Sanath Panavanage is a chartered engineer specialized in electronic and telecommunication engineering and a fellow of the Institution of Engineers, Sri Lanka. His multidisciplinary academic and professional background spans across electronic and telecommunication engineering, industrial mathematics, and business administration. And his research interests include radio wave propagation modeling and diffusion of space technologies. Engineer Panavanagi is currently functioning as the DG and CEO of Atha Siklak Institute. Prior to this appointment in 2008, he was functioning as the Deputy Director General in charge of engineering of the Sri Lanka Broadcasting Corporation. He is credited with the pioneering role he has been playing in acquisition and development of Sri Lanka's national capacity in space technologies, initiating and leading several key programs, including the Nano Satellite Development Program and the project for development of the National Hub for Earth Observation Satellite Data. He initiated and led as the principal investigator the Ravana 1 nano satellite project that developed and launched the first ever Sri Lankan built satellite Ravana 1 into orbit in June 2019. We all were very proud for that achievement as Sri Lankans. Engineer Panavanagi has played an active role in multiple international platforms on space technology cooperation. He has functioned as the chairman of the Intergovernmental Consultative Committee ICC of the Asia Pacific Regional Space Applications Program, RESAP, of the United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific, UNESCAP, in four sessions, including the current 2019-20 session. So you can see the involvement, heavy involvement of Sanath in especially in space technology domain, and as a chartered engineer, he is well deserved to be holding this position for many years now. With that introduction, let me hand over the session to Sanath. And after the session, the game rule is, please, as you have already done, please switch off your mics and videos. Only the speaker will switch on video and mic. Please raise your questions on the chat box. So at the end of Sanath's presentation, I will take up all your questions with Sanath. So please raise your questions on the chat box. Thank you for your patience, and I apologize for the small delay. I let more and more to join with us due to office off time. Okay, Sanath, over to you.
Hi, Bohan, and good evening to
your mic is off, you. Sanath. Your mic is muted.
Well, it doesn't. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
No, we can't hear you.
But it doesn't.
I think we can hear Dr. Lalit.
Hello.
Yeah.
Lalit, can you hear me?
Still, we can't hear you, Sanath.
What about the others?
No, not yet.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Let me try to communicate with Lalit on the mobile. So must be some problem at that end.
Okay. One is saying she can hear. Anuradha, can you hear?
Lalit. Yes.
Yeah, we can hear. Dr. Lalit, we can hear.
Yes, we can hear.
Right. Okay, now it's working. Right. Thank you, Sanath. Okay. Sorry for that small thing. Right. So okay. You can share your slide, Sanath, now.
Okay. Thanks. Lalit, can you see the slides?
Yeah. Perfect.
Okay. Once again, Ivan, and good evening to all our colleagues. It's a real pleasure to be with IET, being a past executive committee member. So this is a good occasion to. I see in the participants list some of the known names. Some of our younger colleagues who have been working with us at the IET committee during the past few years. Before I begin my presentation, I need to thank Lalit for this invitation. Thank you very much, Lalit. I'm really glad to be involved with this IET Evening Forum. And well, I must also thank Professor K.K. Y.W. Perera, who has given this idea. So, well, as we are behind the schedule, so let me straight away get onto the subject. So this talk for the next few minutes is going to be on acquisition of national capacity in space technologies and applications as an imperative for development. Well, space technology, actually the term space technology is used to refer to an ensemble of technologies that are used in exploration and use of outer space. There are a multitude of technologies that are involved in this process, and the technologies are basically, from a functional standpoint, are related to development, launch, and operation of artificial satellites and other spacecrafts. And that includes such foundation technologies as electronic and telecommunication engineering, which a lot of us joined here are related to, aeronautical engineering, power systems, robotics, mechanical engineering, information technology, materials engineering, and chemical engineering. So there are two spheres of distinct activity involving outer space. One is the more fundamental, more idealistic search into the greater depths of outer space, an enterprise which is better known as space exploration. And so we are not pretty much into that. This involves looking at the stars and planets beyond the solar system. And we are more concerned about exploitation of this vantage point of outer space for literally more down-to-earth applications. Though they are down-to-earth, they are the more enterprising applications. That is what we actually identify as space technology applications. So let's have a look at what we generally refer to as space technology applications, or space applications, as it is commonly referred to. There is no agreed upon definition for space applications or space technology applications, but one of the most widely used definitions or rather descriptions of space applications involves these three areas: satellite communication systems, and atmospheric and earth observation satellite systems, and global navigation and positioning satellite systems. And these are the three major categories of applications of space technologies. Sometimes there are some authors who add space exploration also as another application, and there are some other authors who actually refer to exclusively earth observation, I mean remote sensing and geographic information systems and geospatial data as applications of geospatial data as space applications. So there is no globally agreed upon definition, but this is the kind of notion that it means to a lot of people in the industry. So I think it would be worthwhile to have a look at some of the historical perspectives. We know most of the modern technologies, most of the advanced technologies have their origins or beginnings sometimes in military applications. I think when it comes to space technologies, this is unrivaled. You cannot think of another technology, another domain of technology, where the origins have been mainly in the area of military applications, though it has found widespread applications almost all facets of human activity, in all facets of development activity present day. When it comes to space technology, actually it has its most of the development, most of the early development of space technology has happened in what we call the Cold War era. The Cold War between the Soviet Union at that time and the United States of America has mostly taken the form of a space race. So space was a domain where they were trying to compete with each other and to overpower the others with their lifting capabilities, because lifting capabilities were necessarily related to their capabilities in intercontinental ballistic missiles, and that's how it all started. And therefore, the space race, actually the arms race between the two countries manifested mostly in the form of a space race. Everybody was trying to achieve successive steps in terms of acquiring advanced capabilities in space. So this is a very important starting point. In the space race. In fact, we know the Sputnik 1, which was launched by the Soviet Union in 1957, October 4, 1957, was the first ever artificial satellite to be launched by humans. So this was a very important first step, and this marked a very important point in the technological history of the humans. And the human race itself, when they launched this first artificial satellite into space. But there was a big race between the two superpowers to achieve this goal. So Russians managed to do this, and they managed to beat Americans in this feat to become the first nation to launch an artificial satellite into space. And this was soon followed by the Americans in a couple of months' time, but they couldn't become the first. So then when it comes to Earth observation, the beginning of what we refer to as Earth observation satellites, spy satellites, lies in what we call this Corona satellite system that was operated by the United States from 1959 to 1972. This was a substitution for reconnaissance aircrafts, which had been used by them before this system. So they were, at the time of this, at the height of Cold War, they used to have a lot of reconnaissance flights about the Soviet Union and also China to do a lot of spying. And the Russians were also doing that. There were so many situations when those reconnaissance flights, regardless of however advanced they were shot down by Russian military. And so this was a huge challenge. So they wanted to
Sanab, sorry to disturb. You can make the full presentation view of the slide so that the view would be more broader.
I didn't reckon that. Yeah.
Right. Thank you.
Okay. Lalith, let me take this opportunity to find out the voice level and sound level. Everything is okay, right?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. This is a very interesting exercise. Actually, they launched a satellite, and they used that satellite to carry nothing more complex than photographic films. So photographic films were used to, map those militarily sensitive sites of their opponents. This was being used by the United States to basically monitor the military sites of Soviet Union and also China mainly. Some of these, I mean, they were the photographic films that were used were sometimes something like 16,000 feet. So 16,000 feet of photographic films were being used. And the most, unbelievable in today's terms, the most exciting or astonishing thing was that the way that they were using, the technique they were using to get what they were recording on those photographic films. It was nothing other than just dropping those films from satellites in orbit. And as you can see, to get an aircraft which was specially designed for that purpose with a special cloud to go there and to catch those films. As those films were entering into the atmosphere, I mean, they were getting detached from the capsules, and then it was coming in the form of it was making use of a parachute, and this parachute was giving them a gradual descent to the ground. As it was gradually descending, these aircrafts were used to go there, and the claw, you can see this claw, that claw was used to, you know, catch them. Most of you wouldn't have imagined that you would be doing something like this with satellites. And this is exactly how they were collecting those photographic films. And then the aircraft, once it caught with that claw, it could, you know, winch that into the aircraft, and that was then taken to the ground to do the rest. On the right-hand side, what you can see is a pretty good photographic film that had been filmed by this Corona satellite system. This is a photograph of the Pentagon. You can see the shape of, you can readily identify the shape of the Pentagon. So this went on. Actually, this process started somewhere around 1959, and it went until 1972, but the rest of the world didn't know about this because this was a classified secret. And the world came to know there had been a system of satellites called Corona satellites, which were using photographic filming for Earth observation, taking photographs of the Earth. The world came to know about this only in 1995, when President Clinton declassified this classified secret. So you can see how secretly some of these, how much in secrecy some of these early developments in space technology had been kept by both superpowers, United States of America and also USSR. Then this was another historic feat. As we all know, Yuri Gagarin became the first man in outer space. That was in 12th of April, 1961. And actually, this was another historic moment where Russians scored another first in their space race. And obviously, this would not make Americans very pleased. With this Vostok 1 flight, actually, he made 108 minute flight, one orbital flight around the Earth. And then he descended in this capsule, and close to the Earth, he actually came out of the capsule and then used parachute to come down and descend to the Earth. So that's how it was done. And that created another historic milestone of the entire history of human race. And of course, it made a dramatic turn of events when it prompted US to come up with this. So Yuri Gagarin made his historic flight on the 12th of April, 1961. And in the following month itself, President Kennedy of the United States made this historic speech at a joint session of the United States Congress. Actually, his idea was immediately after he came to know that they got defeated once again in their race to send a human being into the outer space, once again by months or by weeks. So he wanted to, you know, come up with something where they would score a significant first step. And it is said that he called his vice president, President Lyndon Johnson at that time, and wanted him to come up with an idea where they would, a feat that would be sufficiently ahead of time so that they will have a greater chance of succeeding rather than, you know, allowing Russians to, you know, once again beat them in their race. So they came up with this idea of, you know, putting a man on moon. One of the technical explanations of this is actually in terms of lifting power, that is in terms of how much weight you can lift and how much height you can achieve. Russians were actually far ahead of Americans at that time. So if they were setting some other goal, the chances that they would have found themselves once again falling short would have been significant, would have been substantial. So therefore, they didn't want to take a chance. So they went for a very big, very challenging task, which would be challenging, equally challenging for both Americans and Russians. So that had been the idea. So in this historic speech, he said that, okay, this is a project that would cost a lot of money. So we have, if you want to be the first nation to beat, in his words, to beat freedom, so to beat, in their words once again, beat tyranny with freedom. So you need to do something like that. And if you want to do that, it has a cost, and the American people and the senators, everybody will have to bear that cost. There's a huge burden, and we should be able to put up that effort and also to bear that burden. And that was his speech. And the Congress agreed. And then, of course, he made this very important, very famous speech, which is vividly recorded in the history books of space, what he made in September the same year at Rice University in Texas, where he made this very important statement, say that America will land a man on the moon and bring him safely back to Earth before this decade's end. In fact, they were able to do that before that decade ended. That was in 1969, although sadly, Kennedy was not there to witness that historic event. So this is supposed to be the peak of this space race between the two superpowers. And also this is supposed to be arguably the most important landmark feat in the evolution of space. And then beyond that point, of course, there was a time then the space race was subsiding. And in 1975, they were, even in the middle of the Cold War, even at the time the conventional militaries were, military forces were actually, pretty much in Cold War. Symbolically, these two spacecraft, Soyuz and Apollo, docked in space. And that was in 1975. And you can see this very, historic picture where a US astronaut is handshaking with a Russian cosmonaut after these two spacecrafts, the Russian Soyuz and the American Apollo, docked in space. So that was a very important point where the two nations actually came in for some kind of collaboration in space. Whatever that was going on Earth in the area of space, they were coming in for some kind of collaboration that was also subsiding the pressures of the space race that the two nations were engaged in. The era that followed led to more and more collaboration in space. And this is a very important landmark event. The major spacefaring nations came together on this very, the largest ever scientific project that the humanity has undertaken, that is the building of what is called the International Space Station, a project that was collaboratively built by NASA. National Aeronautics and Space Agency of the United States, that is the National Space Agency of the United States, and the Roscosmos, Russian State Space Corporation, NASA equivalent of Russia, and Russia, and then European Space Agency, where there are some 26 members, and of course the leading members are Germany, the United Kingdom, France, Italy, and then Japanese Aerospace Exploration Agency, JAXA, and then Canadian Space Agency. So it's a joint project by all these collaborative project by all these space powers, and it's a huge huge laboratory, so to say, in space, where engineers and scientists are carrying out their scientific experiments and engaged in various space related experiments. So this laboratory is the size of several football grounds, and it's at an orbit of 400 kilometers above the Earth, and it is going about the Earth every 1.5 hours, that is every 90 minutes. When we launched Ravana, one satellite, actually we made use of the Japanese module on board this International Space Station to eject our satellite into the orbit, because we wanted to make use of this facility because it's low cost and we had this collaboration. So it was the International Space Station that was used to launch that satellite also. So in launching some of those small satellites of that size, International Space Station is being used by a lot of countries. So that's a very significant landmark collaboration project where those countries came together. So let's look at these space applications. And So we identified what we refer to as space applications. So let's look at the first category, satellite communication systems. And we all know that it was Arthur C. Clarke, whom we all know, who came up with this historic idea in 1945, when he wrote that historic article to A Wireless World, where he said that three satellites which are kept in what he called the geostationary orbit, that is just 35,766 kilometers above the surface of the Earth on the equatorial plane, and rotating in the same direction as the rotation of the Earth, would stand geostationary, that is stationary with respect to Earth. And if you have three such satellites in that orbit, 120 degrees apart from one another, so with that you would be able to cover the entire Earth. So actually this idea of orbital mechanics was there from the time of Newton. And the idea of radio communication was there from 1900, I mean, when Guglielmo Marconi came up with wireless communication. So this is the instance where these two ideas, one idea that was there for more than 200 years, and another idea that was more than 45 years old by that time, radio communication, came together, and he, with his futurist visionary thinking, postulated that idea. But Arthur himself didn't ever believe that this would ever come true during his time. Then, of course, there were a lot of others who were working on the idea. And before, within 20 years of this idea, then space engineers working in the industry were able to, you know, make it a reality. In 1964, the first geostationary satellite was launched. That was SINCOM 3, and then that was used to relay Tokyo Olympics to the United States, a historic feat once again. And then this was followed by international telecommunication satellite series Intelsat the same year. So these are the applications of satellite communication. So they're used for mobile telephony, television, satellite-based mobile telephony, television and radio broadcasting, internet and global maritime communication. So we don't have to go into those details. And by the end of year 2018, there were approximately 790 active satellites in the geostationary orbit. And just to give you an idea of how crowded the geostationary orbit is, so this is what it looks like. So this with the 790 satellites. Now we come to the next major area of space applications, Earth observations. Basically, a process of identifying the Earth's surface features. They may be geographical features, biological features or physical features, those properties, you know, identification of those properties using electromagnetic radiation as the medium of interaction. So in this process, so satellites can depend on either passive sensors or active sensors. When they're depending on passive sensors, what they're basically doing is, you know, detecting some signals that are emitted from the Earth. It may be sun's radiation, which is reflected by the Earth. When they're being used with active sensors, so we call them radar or LIDAR. So when actually they are reflected, they are emitted by the satellite, and then the reflection by the desired element on the Earth is detected by the satellite. So the types of imagery, they can be what you call panchromatic. These are the black and white images, or rather single color images that you see. They can be multispectral, that is, you know, the within the visual band, there can be something like four bands, four different spectral bands. Or they can be hyperspectral, in which case the total spectrum is divided into something like 200 small spectral bands, and then those different spectral bands will be reflecting different signals differently. And microwave also is being used, as we told earlier. This is what we do in radar satellites. So how is this characterization done? The target signature, that is the target that is being observed, is of course, that is reflecting this electromagnetic radiation, whether it is infrared light or whether it is visible light or whether it is microwave, this is what it is doing. So the spectral variation is the fundamental parameter that is used in characterizing that signal, which means, you know, the various objects on the Earth, depending on their geographical, geometric and then physical and biological properties, they will be reflecting different wavelengths differently. So that is the spectral variation. Then, of course, spatial variation, that is variations of reflectance or emittance determined by the shape and size of the target. And then, of course, we are also taking into account the temporal variations, that is the image that you saw during day and the night, and the variations of the images depending on time, you know, from this day to a date that is in next week, or maybe a couple of days later, or maybe in another season, I mean, from this season to another season. And once again, the signal changes depending on the polarization of the signal. So that is also another parameter that is used in determining the properties of the objects that are being monitored, depending on their interaction with those objects. So for example, the spectral variation, as you can see on the horizontal axis, what you see is the wavelength, and the level of reflectance is what we have on the vertical axis. So therefore, you know, as you can see, I mean, depending on where the reflection is coming from, as you can see, it is reflecting various wavelengths at different levels of reflectance. So that is the property. This is what we call spectral signature, the spectral signature of vegetation, spectral signature of dry soil, spectral signature of turbid water. So that's how, that is the characterization that is being used to, you know, distinguish between those properties depending on the signature of the signal. There is a variation of the signal that you get. So this spatial resolution, you can see, you know, this is 1 kilometer, 1 kilometer spatial resolution. That is, 1 pixel represents 1 kilometer, 360 meter, 80 meter, 72 meter, 56 meter. And when it comes to something like 1 meter, you can see the buildings and all that. And of course, nowadays, satellite images of, fraction of a meter, fraction of a couple of centimeters is very common for civilian lab, even civilian applications. And so this has been increasing. You know, you can see how this spatial resolution has been rising from around 1970s, when they had first satellites, like first observation, Earth observation satellites like Landsat, up to about 2015, according to this figure. So they have been, on this axis, you can see this has been something like 100 meters here, 1 pixel representing 100 meters, whereas around this time it is less than 1 meter, and it is very much close to 10 centimeters. And corona is not here, because corona was actually not a satellite system, or not using this, reflectance as such. I mean, it was using reflectance, but it was actually taking photographs, so it was a different system of satellites. So how temporal resolution is being used? So these are some, farmlands, in certain parts of India, for example. You know, you can see, depending on the growth of crops in these areas, how the pictures have been changing. So from 25th of June to 25th of May next year. So by the end of year 2018, there were approximately 670 satellites in the low Earth orbit between these altitudes. So some of the applications, so in the area of agriculture and soil, you can use it for crop acreage, then soil and land degradation mapping, watershed development, and then in the area of forest and environment, forest cover and pipe mapping, forest fire and risk mapping, biodiversity characterization, and then in the area of water, command area of irrigation systems, and then monitoring reservoir sedimentation. And these are also some applications in the area of land use and land cover mapping, and in the area of weather and climate, extended range monsoon forecasting, and in as an example of ocean applications, there is this potential fishing zone mapping where the satellite is using the, you know, temperature variations on the surface of the ocean, and also presence of chlorophyll on the ocean, which causes ocean color to change. And on the one hand, it detects ocean color. On the other hand, it detects the presence of chlorophyll. So when there is chlorophyll, there is a breeding site for small fish. And so this combination is being used to identify fishing zones. So it's being used in disaster management, flood damage assessment, drought monitoring, landslide hazard zonation. Extensive applications. So we'll not go into the details of all these things. So then when it comes to global navigation satellite systems, the third major category of satellite applications. So this is basically about, you know, timing, precise timing and precise positioning, navigation applications. You're able to exactly know the particular point on the surface of the Earth at a particular time, a precisely defined time at a precise the precise location. So those are the satellites that are mainly used for navigation. And there are six systems. The first three systems, GPS of the United States, actually, the common name actually is the Global Navigation Satellite Systems. That is a technology. The technology is Global Navigation Satellite Systems. Actually, GPS is the US developed technology, US developed Global Navigation Satellite System technology. So, but most of the people refer to this as GPS, but that is only one particular technology which is developed by one country, that is United States. Russia also has the same satellite system, and that is called GLONASS. And then China also has by 2020, they have a fully operational global navigation satellite system. So, of course, today, there are three fully globally present global navigation satellite systems by US, Russia, and China. Then there are some regional satellite systems, European system Galileo. Then Japan has this quasi-zenith satellite system. And India has a system called Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System. In fact, Prime Minister Modi gave it a different name. He called it NAVIC. Navigation with Indian Constellation. So these are the main applications: surface and air navigation. Surface transportation, trains, and other transportation systems make use of that. And air navigation obviously uses that, and shipping uses that, and maritime navigation, surveying and mapping. This is a very important application because geographic reference and all these things precisely possible with GNSS satellites. Then satellite-based tracking, and even in precision agriculture, big farm vehicles are fitted with these applications, so that the big agricultural machinery, when they are automated, they know exactly where to, at which particular precise point on the farm, on the land. Where it has to put the seed, if it is used for seeding, or does it have to, if it is used for plucking something in harvesting, then how it is done. So all these things are controlled by GPS systems. So satellite, maybe mobile satellite communications is another area. So when you look at the Sri Lankan roadmap for acquisition of space technologies in national development, so this is actually identified as a very important core technology that the country needs to develop in developing countries' capabilities in actually transforming the economy into a more technology-driven economy, and also in making use of advanced technological capabilities in driving economic development, socio-economic development. So space technology has been identified as one of the core technologies. So this has been, you know, identified in the policy documents of the government, actually thanks to the interventions by the Arthur C. Clarke Institute. And so therefore, we have developed this national roadmap for acquiring basic capabilities in space technologies. So there are three strategic elements that have been identified in that national roadmap. One is, of course, in the area of Earth observation satellite data. So when you look at, you know, we have seen a host of applications, when it comes to use of satellite data, Earth observation satellite data. Of course, you can't think of an area where satellite data is not being used in development applications, in governance, in everything that we do in our everyday life. So, but unfortunately, it's not being used to the extent it should be using in this country. And the fundamental bottleneck for that is that the country is not in a position to access satellite data as frequently as we would like, and in much variety and much diversity of data as we would like. So that's the most important bottleneck. So Arthur C. Clarke Institute, as the national institution which is responsible for developing capacity of space technologies and applications in the country, came up with this proposal some time ago. And that was in year 2014. That was the time we submitted this to the government, the National Planning Department. The government approved that. But then, of course, it took quite a while to mobilize resources for that, you know, to find funding and to look at collaborators. So then we came up with this other program, that is to, you know, develop the capacity of Sri Lankan engineers to build satellites. So we need to acquire our capabilities to develop our own satellites. That doesn't mean that we'll be able to, or we are planning to develop all the satellites that we would need to get all the Earth observation satellite data that we would need. But all the countries are at the moment, finding it very important to, you know, develop that capacity because on the one hand, it can develop satellites. It will be able to use that knowledge to develop the satellites that it wants for various specific applications, which will not perhaps be served by some of the foreign satellite. And on the other hand, so when you develop this capability, it is essentially integration of technologies, because it has a lot of technologies going together to build a satellite. The fact that you can build a satellite, bring these multiple technologies together, bring these multiple subsystems together, and build a satellite and launch it and then operate that in the orbit under very harsh conditions, means that your country's engineers are capable of, you know, making use of the same knowledge in all these areas to come up with various advanced technology products. So that's one of the ideas. That's one of the reasons why a lot of countries are giving a lot of attention to satellite development. So then, in addition to that, we are engaged in domain-specific research activities with various agencies in agriculture, agencies in irrigation, agencies in environment, coastal management, and all that, to do domain-specific research activities with which we'll be able to develop some applications on the use of satellite data and on the use of satellite technologies in general to solve the problems that they encounter in carrying out their activities. So this is the national hub. This is going to come up at Homagama, at Pitipana, a place called Thalagilavatha. Actually, we managed to, you know, get a foreign collaborator for this, so we don't have to spend for the development of the technology infrastructure. In fact, there are a couple of foreign collaborators who have agreed to come on board after this one. So this will be operational in by end of 2021. That was our target. This corona, it might get by another couple of months. So in all probability, it should be operational in early part of 2022. With this going into operation, of course, we will be having access to, you know, all major global Earth observation satellites, and we should be able to use that data for all the applications that we discussed earlier. And, you know, a visual image of what it would look like. So the dish is housed inside this, you know, spherical cover. So this is the site. And then we come to the other area, that is National Capacity Development in Space Technology. Actually, for this, we formulated this nanosatellite development program. And the first nanosatellite that was developed under that was Ravana-1, which you all know, which was launched into orbit last June. And so it has been in orbit since last June. It's operating at altitude of 400 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. And it's going about the Earth every 90 minutes, 91 minutes to be exact. And we are receiving research data from the satellite continuously. And this is being received by ACCMT ground station, which is a small ground station that we have assembled for this purpose. Of course, these are some details about the mission. So it's in this orbit, and the period is 92.6 minutes, and inclination is 51.6, and these are some of the subsystems, but I will not go into the details of those things. The most important thing is that, you know, those subsystems, this is a very small satellite, though it is a small satellite, it has all the major subsystems, all the main subsystems of a bigger Earth observation satellite. Therefore, once we acquire that capability, once our engineers acquire that capability, of course, it's just a matter of scaling up. So some of the boards of the satellite, and this is, you know, how we are tracking at the Arthur C. Clarke Institute ground station. You can see how the satellite is moving all the time. So this is ISS, actually. This is the satellite. So this, some of the facilities. And some images Ravana-1 has made. So you can see this slightly elongated picture of Sri Lanka here, part of that here, and some other regions of the Earth. And based on that success, actually, we have now, Ravana was actually our collaboration with this Kyushu Institute of Technology. And there was a team of six engineers who were on that mission. And but a lot of publicity was given to the two engineers who were developed in, who were involved in, you know, assembling the satellite in Kyushu. Dulani and Parindu. And then a lot of others were working from here. And Earth observation, so this is the next collaboration that we are having, but that's a collaboration of five parties. That's a much bigger one, a six-unit satellite. And it will have some very interesting applications as well. So this is going to have a 5-meter resolution color imagery, which is, you know, where the images will be much higher resolution. Ravana was a technology demonstration, so that was using 300-meter resolution. whereas this is using 5 meter resolution, so much improved resolution. Then there's another mission called Spatium, where an onboard experiment is taking place about onboard processing rather than ground station processing. Then there's another data communication mission called LoRa mission. So the most important thing is, you know, we are testing all these technologies at 400 kilometers and under very harsh conditions, from one side of the satellite to the other side of the satellite, meaning from the side that is exposed to sun to the side that is shadowed by the satellite, there's a temperature difference of 80 degrees centigrade. And radiation is so harsh. So the satellite is being tested and it's subject to so much of, you know, electromagnetic, you know, impact. So as a result, you know, when you test that under those conditions, of course, so that becomes space tested. That is why some other institutions which are involved in commercial satellite industries have come on board and they have joined this program together with Kyushu Institute of Technology, which is the institution which is coordinating that, and we are there. And then Nanyang Technological University of Singapore is there, and these two institutions which are working in the space industry have also come on board because they see the potential of this satellite. So this will be launched early next year. And this is some landmarks about how it was historically happening. I mean, 2014, we developed this project proposal, and this was submitted to the Department of National Planning, and we basically the other government authorities. You know, it was done at the time of Mr. Champika Randavarga was the minister, and that was an important landmark. And then 2015 October, actually we had another important milestone where we were admitted to United Nations Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space. This is where we got the membership. In 2015. And this is the highest forum of the United Nations system on space. And it is very important to get the membership of that. And it's rather difficult. I mean, at that time, it was rather difficult for countries, but some of the other, we managed to become a full member of UN Corpus with the support of all other 77 members who were there at that time. And then in 2017, we had another important agreement. Actually, we signed this agreement with Roscosmos, that is NASA's equivalent of Russia. And of course, you can also see Minister Susil Premijanta and the Russian ambassador at that time. And immediately following that time, I managed to send a 17-member team of our engineers to Russia, to the place where this Vostok 1 satellite was built. There is a place called Samara Space Space University. So they underwent training there, and that's how this satellite program started. Then, of course, we went into this collaboration with Japan, with United Nations involvement. And it's almost 8:50, sorry, 7:50. So we have, we started at around 7.
I think I gave you the forum around, 6:52, 6:53, like.
Yeah.
So you can go on for another 4 or 5 minutes.
Yeah. Okay, I'll try to finish. Thanks, Lalit. We'll skip some of these things. Actually, what I want to say is we have identified these requirements from all our agencies like Agrarian Development Department, Agriculture Department, Ministry of Fisheries, and, urban development and all these places. Actually, we have sent out a questionnaire to some 90 organizations to find out their requirements in satellite data and their possible applications of space technologies so that we could facilitate them. So I'll give more details about that in a minute. And this is a project that we have done actually where we have been able to precisely estimate the paddy harvest using satellite data. This is very important because at the time, by the time the government knows, the country knows what the harvest of yellow season is going to be, it's already 1.5 months into the maha season and vice versa. So we carried out this pilot project for Ampara district. You can see what we predicted was 205,000 metric tons, whereas actual was 193, which is very, very, very accurate prediction. So I'll skip some of these details about various applications of various possible government agencies. And also, I just want to share with you that we have also gone into a related area, that is unmanned aerial vehicle development, because most of the times you have to complement satellite data with the data that you get through unmanned aerial vehicles. For that purpose, we are developing our own unmanned aerial vehicles, which are capable of going up to about, at the moment we have capability of going up to about 100 kilometers and then carrying, some of these drones are capable of carrying payloads, something like 4 kilograms, fully capable of carrying the remote sensing payloads that we want them to carry. And some developments, we are very happy that we were able to do this within a very short time. So this is complementing our satellite capabilities. And then some of the projects that we have been carrying out with Sri Lanka Navy and Air Force and also STF and various other government agencies using drones. And international cooperation plays a very important role. On the one hand, of course, countries like us, when we develop our national technological capabilities in a technology like space technology, which has been evolving within the highly guarded walls of national space agencies of some leading spacefaring nations, it is a hugely challenging task. So therefore, we need to engage in international cooperation, which we have been carrying out lot of success. Actually, that has been the cornerstone of our success. Why we have been able to actually, as a developing country, why we have been able to achieve what we have achieved, what many countries would agree is a significant achievement within a matter of few years. We have heavily depended on very successful international collaboration. So that's one of the reasons why international collaboration is important. On the other area, of course, space is a global common pool resource and it's governed by a set of international laws and principles. So to ensure our compliance as a country, as a sovereign state, with those international conventions and laws on the one hand, and to align our national policies and legislation governing space with those international policies and laws, we need to engage in international cooperation. So we have been active in these forums, United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific. It has come up with this 12-year action plan. Of course, we were happy that we were. As a country, we are happy that we were able to be the co-chair in developing this UN-adopted 12-year plan of action for space applications for the Asia-Pacific region, which covers 60 countries and which covers all 12 years from 2018 to 2030. And then, so we also have these collaborations with all these international platforms that I have listed, but I'm not going into details of those things, rather than to say that one of the cornerstones of Sri Lanka's success, Arthur C. Clarke Institute's success in harnessing and leveraging the maximum capability of these international cooperative platforms, you know, that has been the cornerstone of our success in achieving. So so let me just say one word about this last slide. So this is a survey that we are carrying out at the moment to identify capacity gaps of our government institutions. So how much staff would they need? How many people with master's level qualifications or other professional training that they would need in this area to have an effective space technology application section in this area? And what are the resources that they need? What kind of hardware, software, and other facilities, access to satellite data, basically? And then what kind of institutional structures they would need? I mean, separate divisions and various processes and things like that. And then in order to facilitate all that, what kind of policy interventions should be made by the government? So the purpose of this survey, which we call Space Technology Applications for Sustainable Development, the National Survey on the Current and the Potential Use Among Public Sector Organizations. This is currently on, and Arthur C. Clarke Institute is doing this to give to the government the policy interventions that it should be making in order to, you know, facilitate all government institutions to begin with, and also to facilitate learning activities of the academic institutions so that the country will develop the necessary human resources to harness the potential of this vital technology, and then to come up with the necessary institutional structures. So as the agency which is entrusted with responsibility, we have launched this survey, and we will be, you know, finishing this in a couple of months' time. So this is what I would like to share. Thanks, Lalit. So it went almost nearly the initial 1 hour despite the delay, but we will certainly have some time for a couple of questions, Lalit. So with this, thanking you all, let me conclude. Thank you very much for your patient listening.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Sanat. It was a very informative and very knowledge-provoking presentation. And as you know, most of us are kind of distant to space technologies, considering our work environment. So you are very fortunate to have been able to work in this very interesting domain. At the outset, I want to say tell you that I had the luck of visiting both Russian and US space technology institutions. So you may have also visited in US. Yeah, close to Orlando, they have this all space technology, the museum, and even Neil Armstrong's space shuttle, and what is coming back. You know, I was fortunate to see them, and in Russia, even I have seen the small capsule where Yuri Gagarin was seated, and when it came back, they have the museum, and I was fortunate to see both the Russian and US the space museums. And also I am currently working with the Fisheries Ministry for a project on VMS, Vessel Monitoring System, where we will obtain satellite communication services as well. So just to give you some information, and also there have a...
I'm glad IED has a chairman who is, you know, pretty well versed in this area.
Yeah, yeah. and there were like around 10 questions.
I can see them, Lalit. Actually, let me pick. The first.
I can take you one by one. So the first question was to what extent is spectral signature correct?
Well, when you say spectral signature is the is a signal, is a pattern that you get due to the fact that various spectral bands or various frequencies, or in other words, wavelengths, are reflected in different ways by depending on the biological properties, physical properties, or the properties of the object that we are looking at. For example, I mean, if we take vegetation, so vegetation, the way it reflects green light, and the way it reflects red light, and the way it reflects infrared are different. So therefore, I mean, using those things, we derive something called normalized difference vegetation index. That's basically looking at the magnitude of the signals reflected in the red band and the magnitude of the signal that is reflected in the infrared band, the difference divided by the sum, normalized difference. So that is how it is being measured. Its accuracy depends on the sensor that is being employed, and when it comes to something like multispectral or hyperspectral, also the number of bands that you are using is also going to have an impact.
Okay, thank you, Sanath. I think it is well explained. Next question is: as an expert, how do you see the future of space technology and application development of Sri Lanka? I think you elaborated certain things in your last slides.
This is a very important question. This is what we are trying to address, I mean, from a policymaking point of view, and in fact, rather than from policymaking, from the point of view of technology development and development of national capacity in the country. Well, as I said, one of the biggest bottlenecks is actually from a qualitative point of view, Lalit, something that we can be very happy is that there's a you go to any organization, go to agriculture department, go to irrigation, go to Mahavali, go to meteorology department, go to disaster management center, coastal environment, urban development authority, any of those organizations, they always have some engineers and scientists who have a fundamental working knowledge in this area.
Yeah.
But the problem is this, when you go into the details, you see how it has happened is one of these guys have actually gone on a foreign training, and he has actually, maybe they have followed a master's program or a postgraduate program on their sheer interest, they have started some section. That's how these things have been running.
Yeah.
That is one problem. That is one side of the capacity problem. And on the other hand, as I elaborated, one of the biggest problems that we have is that we do not have access to satellite data as often as we would like. You know, for example, if you're interested in, monitoring the growth of paddy, I mean, you need to look at the growth of paddy plant every 1 week. There's no point in trying to have some satellite data 1 month later, because some of these things you can't do that way. There are things that you can do that way, even if the data is late, but there are certain things where you need to get the data then and there to be in a position to make the decisions, to do the analysis that you want to make. So that is the problem. That is the fundamental question that we are trying to address by establishing what we call this national hub for receiving and distribution of Earth observation satellite data. So by 2022, or if you are fortunate, by end of 2021, we would solve that problem. So there'll be a lot of other research. There'll be collaborative research, because more and more scientists will be using that. More and more engineers will be using that data. Then, believe me, there'll be a big difference in the way that those sectors are working once they have access to that.
Okay. Thank you. That's a good news. I don't know when the first Sri Lankan will be on space. It will be a long-term plan. Yeah. But who knows? Maybe beyond our lifetime.
Well, actually, it's not that difficult, Lalit. These days, I mean, if you have a lot of money, I mean, you can be in space. I mean, if you can spend maybe 50 million, 60 million US dollar. Now, yeah. This gentleman, Elon Musk, Elon Musk, the boss of SpaceX, also the boss of... he's revolutionizing the space industry. And there are these, private sector giants in space industry. SpaceX and Virgin Galactic and all that. I mean, they're coming in a big way and they're promoting space tourism. Actually, you can go into space and come back. Spend something like maybe $50 million, or it might come down in the time to come. It's not a big deal. Actually, we are not looking at that because it's something that you can get into a spacecraft, go there and come back. The way you're going to Atlanta, perhaps Antarctica those days, or to Alaska those days.
So
important is to be from the space. I mean, you have to look at Earth. I mean, we are not interested that much in looking at space. We want to look at Earth from space and then do whatever that we want to do on the Earth.
Understood. Thank you. So next question is, what are the advantages of nano satellites versus large scale satellites?
Very interesting question. Very fundamental question. Nano satellites are small. When they are small, they cost less money. But although they are small, they have all the main subsystems of a large satellite. So therefore, this is a very important vehicle through which a country can afford to, a developing country like us can afford to develop the capacity of our engineers to build more complex, larger satellites. So that is one thing, that is in terms of capacity development. The other advantage is nano satellites are less costly, and therefore there's a global tendency around the world to switch into constellations of nano satellites to carry out certain tasks that were hitherto being carried out by conventional large satellites. I'm not proposing that all the applications that were handled by these large Earth observation satellites or other types of satellites could be transformed to nano satellites. Definitely no. But a significant proportion of some applications can be transferred to nano satellite constellations. Instead of having a single large satellite, you have a satellite constellation, which costs only a fraction of the cost to build, and you can make use of that, and you can replenish those satellites as quickly as you would like, and it gives a lot of flexibility. So that's one big advantage.
Okay, so the main factor is cost, right?
Main factor is cost, actually.
Okay, right. And in this line, are you working with SLINTEC as well, Sri Lanka Institute of Nanotechnology? Now your space center is also supposed to be in Pitipana. And
not really. In fact, we are all using this term nano, but nanotechnology, of course, there are certain areas where you can use nanotechnology. As of now, we have not looked at that. That is about material science, because when it comes to space, one of the areas is, one of the areas of technology in that technology ensemble is materials technology, materials engineering. So nanotechnology is more about materials engineering, but materials do play a very important role when it comes to satellites, because the weight is a very important criterion, and their various properties of those materials are very important. So there could be certain possibilities in the future when we are going for our other future satellites to think in terms of engaging Sri Lankan capacity in nanotechnology in our materials engineering for satellites as well. But at the moment, we don't have anything.
Okay, thank you. Next question is, what is legal framework to access satellite data?
Well, that's a very interesting question. Actually, I just showed some of these, international legal instruments.
Treaties.
Space is actually a global common pool resource. So what we refer to as outer space is the area, is the region beyond an altitude of generally 100 kilometers. So 100 kilometers and above. So the other laws which are applicable to aerospace industry, aviation and things like that will not apply there. All what applies is international law. The national jurisdictions do not have, do not extend to outer space. Your national jurisdictions, what you may have for anything, ends up there at 100 kilometers, not beyond that. So therefore, outer space is what we call a global common pool resource, like international maritime waters or like, Antarctica. It's a global common pool resource. Anybody can access that. No country can have sovereignty over space, any part of space. And that is exactly why you can't prevent other satellites, other nations' satellites, prevent them from going above your space. Of course, if you do that, nobody can operate satellites that we know, because I mean, they will not be going in these zigzag paths. They're going in elliptical orbit. Therefore, it was very important for this domain to develop. It was fundamentally important that the international community adopted some legal framework. So this legal framework, there are 5 international treaties. All the activities are governed by that, and there are 5 international principles. And then in addition to that, there are a lot of guidelines and declarations that are respected by most of the countries, though they are not binding upon those countries. So those are called soft law. The treaties are called hard law. Once you become a signatory to that, you are bound by that. So the most important thing is what is called the, just as much as Magna Carta is important in constitutional law, when it comes to space, there is a thing called Outer Space Treaty. The long name is the Treaty on Principles Governing the Activities of States in the Use and Exploration of Outer Space, including Celestial Bodies. So it's a long name. So that came into force in 1967. So Outer Space Treaty. So that governs, that sets out a lot of principles that the countries are governed by. So you have to ensure your national legislation, if you have some piece of national legislation on space, that has to conform to those international standards. So it has to definitely conform to International Space Treaty. In other words, this the International Treaty Governing Principles of States, International Treaty on Principles Governing the Activities of Space in the Use of Outer Space and Celestial Bodies. You have to abide by that. Then there are other conventions, like, you know, for example, liability convention. You know, in launching something into space, I mean, if certain things fall on some other country, how the liability is going to be handled. So there's a thing called liability convention. There's another thing called registration convention. I mean, when you send something to space, you've got to register that with United Nations Office for Outer Space Affairs, out of UNOSA. And there's another thing called rescue agreement. That is, if a cosmonaut or an astronaut happens to land in your territory, so you're supposed to hand him over to the country, regardless of your political rivalries and things like that. And there's another thing called Moon Agreement, which says that you can't have, sovereignty over moon or the celestial bodies. I mean, that is not for acquisition by claiming sovereignty on those bodies. There are things like that. When it comes to international space law, the cornerstone is Outer Space Treaty. That covers most of the stuff. Others are supplementary to that.
Okay, fine. So good. There are so many things, although there are no such boundaries in the outer space, but you need to be certainly, adhere to those treaties and frameworks, legal frameworks. Understood.
Certainly. Yes. Otherwise, nobody will be able to operate.
I don't know. Next question is, what is the cost Sri Lanka pays to use GPS and other satellite services?
Basically, there is no cost, actually. So those users do not have to pay. I mean, normal users do not have to pay that kind of cost. But I there is no such big cost involved as such, because the services, obtaining the services, of course, it is the cost of infrastructure, basically.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's the kind of satellite user. I mean, as an institution should pay, right? Individual users.
Yeah, but that's also for only. You need to have a license. You need to have an agreement when it comes to very precise positioning. But general services are, you know, commonly available.
Yeah, but remember, the project I mentioned, the vessel monitoring system for fisheries department.
Yeah.
Each individual vessel which goes on goes to the sea, they should have a transponder on board, and that transponder will communicate with a satellite service. So fisheries department will take that license and they will pay for the satellite service, but ultimately the fishermen have to subscribe for that payments, satellite service, because fisheries department will give them a transponder for their own good and for the good of department, so that they can monitor where they are going and whether they are crossing the boundaries, etc. But for the satellite service, they have to contribute, each fisherman which is going to the sea. So yeah, satellite services are very expensive. I know they have hired for last 3 years for each transponder $17 per transponder, $17.
$17 per minute or something like that?
Per month.
Oh, per month, okay.
Yeah.
When it comes to communication, of course, it can be even more expensive. For example, I mean, if you're using Inmarsat, International Maritime Satellite or something like that making calls from sea, it could cost something like maybe $6-$7 a minute.
I know. They have used Inmarsat, of course. What happened was they have made an agreement 3 years ago, and at that time it was $17 per month. But ultimately, after 2 years, they have added the levy, which is which had come to from $17 to $51 per transponder. So fisheries department is in a big trouble now. They want to renew that agreement with that Inmarsat service provider. Certain things like that.
What happens is, Lalit, when it comes to an operational service, actually what we refer to as GNSS is the basic service. That is positioning and timing. I mean, that's these six satellite operators, basically three operators global at the global level, GPS, GLONASS of Russian Federation, and also Beidou of China. And then we have these regional services like IRNSS and also the Japanese one and all that. Usually, in an application like that, in a vessel monitoring system, or there's another application called vessel traffic monitoring system, which Sri Lanka Boats Authority has subscribed to. So those things are actually, that's a package of services, actually.
Yeah.
So it depends on, you know, the package of services that they have packaged, it has GPS, it has it has some other monitoring systems, it has a facility to have communication with the shore, a lot of things. So they have packaged service, in packaging that service, the type of satellite operators and various satellite related services that they have taken on board, and the value-added services that they are providing. So it all depends. You know, these are commercial offerings.
Okay. Next question is: what are the key factors to be considered in selecting a location for ground station?
That's a very interesting question. one of the most important things is actually if it's a, yeah, particularly if it's a ground station like what we are building, where the antennas are going to be rotating. For example, when a satellite passes over Sri Lanka from south to north or from north to south in a direction like that usually, so that pass, I mean, if it goes above our head at these lower Earth orbits, that is something like, you know, from 2,000 to 20,000 kilometers. So it you know, passes at a time like, you know, within, if it's maybe sometimes 8 minutes, sometimes 10 minutes, something like that. So you need to, you know, get the satellite data during that time, which means your antenna has to be very precise. It has to have a very good gain and it has to be precisely positioned to the, pointed to the satellite, and it has to downlink all the data before the satellite disappears over the horizon. So in that scenario, it is fundamentally important that your satellite is not, you know, obstructed. The line of sight with the satellite from the ground station is not obstructed by anything like buildings, towers, hills, or anything like that. So when we did that calculation for our ground station at Pitipana, actually we had a limit. We had a couple of contours, you know, up to about 500 kilometers, you couldn't have more than a three-storied building or five-storied building, up to a, you know, a distance of about 1 kilometer, you can't have a 10-storied building. So we have given some specifications, planning specifications to the Urban Development Authority for them to take care of in order to ensure that they, when they are giving land to other people to build other areas of this tech city, because this was coming as part of that tech city, I mean tech city land. That's one of the considerations. Then another thing is, I mean, it should not be in close proximity to any installations that could emit harmful electromagnetic interference. For example, you can't have a satellite ground station very close to a mobile base station. We have to stay away from those things to a certain extent. And that is one of the other things. And then of course, grounding is very important. It has to be protected from lightning. So grounding has a role to play. And then another important thing is actually the solidness of ground. It has to be, you know, you need to have solid rock, the ground. Otherwise, you need to have piling going down to big depths. Pile them, you know, have piles going up to greater depths. If the land is not solid. So that's another consideration. Those are the usual consideration. In addition to that, of course, you would like to have a area where rainfall is less. Mm-hmm. Because rain attenuation can be a factor. As you know, all of us have done microwave engineering, I mean, at least basics of that, we know that rain attenuation is higher at microwave frequencies, so it can cause a big attenuation. So that is a fact.
How about the lightning? Whether it is affecting lightning?
Yeah, lightning, of course, you need to have a good lightning protection system. So your ground resistance has to be, you know, suitable for that purpose. But it's not a major consideration. So the major considerations are actually, I would say, you need not have any obstructions. Even rainfall is a consideration, and the other factors that I mentioned.
Okay, right. Thank you. Yeah. How effectively can Sri Lanka use satellite surveillance system for its development? I think you have covered most of the things. You can briefly point out the main points.
When you say satellite surveillance, of course, you can monitor land, you can monitor ocean. Monitoring land is important because, for reasons that to detect various illegal activities and things like that. That's where surveillance could be important. The surveillance is always to most of the times, I mean, more often than not, it is being used to detect illegal activity and things like that, unauthorized activity and things like that. You have to carry out surveillance sometimes to see urban sprawl. I mean, to building of building of unauthorized structures around cities and things like that. You know, these things that result in very messy kind of urbanization. Creation of slums and things like that. Then things like, unauthorized dumping of garbage and things like that. Those things can be subject to surveillance. But I would say the most important part of surveillance is maritime surveillance, because Sri Lanka is having, very soon, going to have full access. Of course, those things are being negotiated to a maritime space, a sea area, which is almost 23 times as the extent as the land. So that's the territory of Sri Lanka. So that's going to be our economic zone. So we need to monitor the activities. We need to monitor the movement of various vessels in that area. And we need to see whether there's any legal activity that is taking place in this area, like, drug smuggling and various and also illegal fishing and illegal exploitation of our maritime ocean resources. So that's a so those are the areas that would be very important in terms of satellite based surveillance.
Yeah, most of what you mentioned we are covering through our vessel monitoring system for fisheries department, because actually we as the international organization for migration are funding for that through Australian government. Actually, Australian government is the most affected country in terms of illegal migration, because the most of the Sri Lankan boats are going to Australia. That's why they want to fund for that project. So most of the illegal activities happening in the sea will be monitored through this vessel monitoring system. That's the main purpose of this project. And also, I was working for the Minister of Defense for last 8 years until last year. And I managed two projects. One was called Maritime Surveillance System, which was involved with 12 stakeholders, all the maritime stakeholders, who has some stake on the sea, like ports authority, Sri Lanka Navy, Sri Lanka Air Force, Coast Guard Department, Fisheries Department, NARA, you name it, and all the sea going, the institution which has some stake on the sea were involved in that project. And it was a massive project to monitor not only exclusive economic zone, even beyond, like 300 nautical miles, we wanted to monitor that project. And then there was another project called Maritime Rescue Coordination Center, because for the International Maritime Organization, Sri Lanka is obliged to look after the same area which you mentioned, 27 times of the sea time, sea land, the extent of sea, sorry, land extent, which goes towards Antarctic. So it's a huge area. We have to look after the distress of commercial ships passing by Sri Lanka. So there were two projects. Yeah. I don't know, the present government will continue.
Yeah.
Those projects were started somewhere in 2015-16 time.
I see.
Yeah.
So AIS, automatic identification.
AIS is the main technology we wanted to use through satellites.
Yeah.
Next question is, what applications we currently use and plan to use GPS data in Sri Lanka?
Right, GPS data. Actually, rather than saying GPS data, we can say GNSS, Global Navigation Satellite Systems.
Yeah.
Surely for aviation, that is, handling of aircrafts, air traffic, So that is one of the fundamental applications. And then, as you mentioned, maritime, you know, navigation. And then those two are two major applications. Then on the land, I would say the most important thing is, you know, surveying. So the Department of Surveying, Survey General's Department is using this for preparation of maps and surveying of land and things like that. And then, in fact, we should be using GNSS systems even for control purposes of railways and things like that, but it's not happening at the moment. But that's the technology that should be happening in, that should be used in that area. But closer home, actually, these things are even important for, you know, to ensure that when you get into a private bus, it doesn't just stop at a certain place and just keeps there. And even for that kind of applications, to ensure that such vehicles, even things like buses that are...
Vehicle tracking systems, right? Vehicle tracking system.
And I mean, those are the very important applications. Actually, we are not a highly industrial, we are not a country where we are using high technology in agriculture at that level. But I would say, going by the size of certain paddy lands in, say, Ampara, Karepattu, the eastern province, and things like that. And given the fact that agro labor is at a huge shortage, I mean, if you see, closely look at those things, sometimes they don't have enough labor in those areas. Sometimes people who are working in these agricultural lands are people who have illegal migrants from India and various places. So, and they're using significantly big agricultural machinery for certain applications. So there may be a possibility that they could be coupled with GIS in the time to come. I wouldn't call it GIS. That is Global Navigation Satellite Systems. It could be GLONASS, it could be GIS, it could be Chinese Beidou, or it could be Indian IRNSS, whatever it is. So that is a possibility, because precision agriculture, as I mentioned during the presentation, is one very important area where they use global navigation satellite systems.
Yeah, thank you. Next question is, what are the key factors in deciding the lifetime of a satellite?
So many. One of the things is the altitude of the satellite. When it comes to Earth observation satellites, of course, higher the altitude, generally, the lifetime becomes better, because you know, at lower altitudes, even at 400 kilometers, for example, it's not completely a vacuum. You know, there is ions and things like that. So that is one of the factors, the altitude. And then, of course, it depends on what kind of satellite you are talking about. When it comes to, it depends a lot on the technologies that you're using. For example, a satellite that we are building, of course, this Ravana 1 satellite, for example. Of course, we think that it would have a lifetime of a few years. Actually, it could be 2 years. We are operating really well, 1.5 years. It's a little more than 1 year now. But it should come down because of the gravity, little by little, because it doesn't have thrusters, because the satellite is very small, it doesn't have thrusters to go up. When it comes to these bigger satellites, they have thrusters, which means, when its altitude comes down, when it comes down a little bit from its original orbit, the satellite has its thrusters. It can operate its thrusters and it can bring it back to that position. So that is not possible with these very small satellites. So those are some of the factors. And other than that, the components that you use in the satellite is very important, because generally for commercial satellites, they have to be space grade. And for military satellites, they have to be military grade, which means, you know, the precision, the level of precision with which you choose those components is very, very accurate. It may be the same semiconductor manufacturer who's manufacturing those components, but their level of quality control, the level of precision that they apply in, you know, in making those components, manufacturing these components, is the key.
Mm-hmm. Understood.
And then, of course, that is components. Then, of course, the how protective the equipment inside the satellite, the systems inside the satellite from those harsh space conditions, from radiation, temperature differences, and things like that. And magnetic, yeah. How you're going to screen them. So it has a big role.
Okay. So it's not proportionate to the money you spent on a satellite, right? As against to a vehicle.
That is. Actually, for example, some of the components that we are using are not, you know, for example, the components that we have used on board Ravana, that's a research satellite. We didn't want to go for the most expensive ones. And we are doing this experiment with not the ones that we are using, actually. Some of the components are things that you would be using for certain other applications on Earth, but some components are special. But when it comes to a commercial application, you wouldn't be experimenting with something like that. You would be using what is called space tested, space grade.
Yeah. Right. Thank you. One before last question. How GIS software are used in satellite applications?
Actually, GIS software is not used in satellite applications. GIS is a software platform. For handling multiple layers of spatial data, right?
Yeah.
But you're using GIS software usually in conjunction with satellite data, remote right. satellite data. So that's the connection.
Right. Okay. Understood. Next question is, how do we improve government policies to encourage space exploration and development of space technologies?
Yes, Dasune, right?
Yeah.
Well, I'm more interested in the second part. And at the moment, I have little interest from the first part, as I said.
The next question you mean, right? Since the government can't play a big role in the space field, what is a good strategy?
I was just saying that in lighter vein. Actually,
okay.
What I mentioned is, you know, I mean, the question concerns two areas. One is space exploration. What is our policy concerning space exploration? And
right.
what is our policy concerning development of space technologies?
Right.
Because, one of the things that we are trying to do, I mean, as the government institution which is responsible for a space technology capacity development in this country and also to handle these space-related matters with the international community and also to advise the government on space policy. So we are taking a keen interest on the second part. Actually, as a developing country, a country with the 80 billion US dollars of GDP and with just 4,000 US dollars of per capita GNI. Space exploration is that's a pretty much ambitious target. So if you look at the countries which are in space exploration, they're basically the two superpowers in space, and also countries like, you know, European Space Agency countries and Canada, then Japan, so most importantly China. China is almost a superpower now. And then India is also a big player in space, those are the countries. and Korea and Israel, they are great. But we don't have such big ambitions in space exploration at the moment. Not that I say that we should not be doing that. We are not, you know, when you look at the cost of those space adventures, so it is, you know, many years, if not decades before, Sri Lanka can think of, you know, venturing seriously into space. But you can get involved in space exploration in conjunction with others, because you can do experiments on space if you want. You know, now even the Chinese space laboratory, similar to ISS, this offers some opportunities for carrying out some experiments in space in conjunction with them. So we can, you know, put some of our experiments to operate in those spacecrafts. That way it is possible. And we can design some equipment to be carried by those spacecrafts. That kind of things are possible. But our major interest is in the area of development of space technologies. There, as I said, our primary interest is in development of satellites on the one hand, and on the other hand, development of ground infrastructure, like this national hub for receiving and distribution of Earth observation satellite data, to facilitate what you call optimal harnessing of the potential of these space technologies in our development activities. How do we use space? How do we use remote sense satellite data to develop our agriculture? How do we ensure that we find out what is the amount of paddy harvest? What is the amount of paddy? How many metric tons? How many hundreds of thousands or millions of paddy harvest are we going to have this yellow season? And at the moment, by the time the government comes to know these things, it'll be halfway through the maha season. So how do we use space technology for that? And how do we use space technology for better urban planning to ensure that our urban planning process is done properly? How do we ensure space technology for all the important surveillance purposes that you were just mentioning? We have a huge economic resource that is, 23 times the equivalent of our geographic territory. So how do we use space technology for those things? Actually, our intention is to address those policies. That is exactly why we have sent that questionnaire to something like 93 or 94 government organizations for them to identify how they would like to use, so how, where they think they can use space technologies for those, to enhance their operations. And we want to tell the government to look here. I mean, these are the areas which we need to address. There is a deficiency of capable staff. There's a deficiency of resources that they need in terms of software and hardware that is needed, in terms of training that they need, in terms of some organizational divisions or sections to carry it out. And those are the policy interventions by the government that we would like to advise the government to intervene. Of course, we will be in a better position to give this message to the government when we conclude this survey.
Okay, good explanation. Thank you. The last question again coming from Dasuni. Since the government can't play a big role in the space field, what is a good strategy to develop the private sector in space technology in our country?
You can't say government can't play a big role because...
You are a government organization, right?
A government organization, and we are playing a key role. The thing is, when it comes to something like space, it is not, most of the time, it is not rewarding for some of the private companies to come here and get into this area to start with. But when a space industry develops to a certain extent, then that is a time when the private sector can come in. For example, I said, let me take a very small example. not in big investments. Private sector might not find it is find it profitable for them, for example, to go and, you know, develop something like a national hub for the satellite data receiving. To be frank with you, I mean, even the government couldn't find money for that. Actually, then we had to, of course, make use of some of the strategic advantages that we had to invite and encourage some foreign partners to come here and co-host their ground stations here. We give them all the facilities, we give them the land, we give them the facilities, they come here and they bring the technology, they give come with the equipment, but it will be operated by our engineers, we'll be in charge of all the operations. So they get the data and we get the data, so it's a really win-win situation. But it's still not possible for a private sector institution to do that. At least the cost of the land is going to be very big. Now, for example, I mean, if it's something like 12 acres in an area like this, so, you know, it's already running into a few hundreds of millions of rupees. So that's not the kind of investment that would be readily borne by a private sector investor. But then there are areas where private sector can definitely come in and play an effective role. For example, space technology, you know, nanosatellite development. At the moment, we are developing the capacity of our engineers at the Arthur C. Clarke Institute, and we're also, you know, trying to build this capacity of the engineers of universities and various others. I mean, basically, Sri Lankan engineers. Our idea is that, you know, someday, maybe a couple of years down the line, if some of those people get together and they develop maybe a maybe a 10-member firm, they can still bring in a lot of foreign revenue, because if you develop one of the small components that would go into the global nano satellite industry, it can bring in much more revenue than a couple of garment factories can bring in, you know, because it's a very small thing. I mean, it's what is needed is knowledge. This is knowledge economy, right? You know, where you can start developing these high-tech components that could go into the growing global nano-satellite industry, for example. And we can develop some systems. You know, you just mentioned vessel monitoring systems. And I mean, in answering that question, I said there's a high degree of what is called systems integration that is taking place. You know, you get facilities from GPS, you get facilities from Inmarsat, and you take all these things, you develop some software and you package it nicely and you deliver it as a state-of-the-art high-tech service. So we have, you know, such capable engineers in all these fields, you know, in electronics and telecommunication engineering, in software engineering and all these fields, who can put together all these things and, you know, come up with that kind of solutions. So it is that is a niche that private sector can come in. And then look at GPS, or rather global navigation satellite. I don't want to promote GPS because that's not happening there.
It is the most familiar in Sri Lanka, the GPS.
Well, use of global navigation satellite systems. You know, I mean, even the apps like what you're using, the app that you are using to call up your, you know, taxi, in a way that is using that kind of systems can be developed using those services. So there is a niche for all these things. There's a niche for all these things, and those are the areas where, and then surveying. Well, those are the areas where private sector can play a big role, I guess.
Okay. So that brings to the end of our session today, and thank you very much, Sanath, once again for accepting my request and continuing this dialogue for 2 hours now. It's exactly 2 hours now since we started at 6:45, and I thank all the survivors until now. It's Friday evening, and it's a very interesting presentation, I would say. because you enlighten us in many aspects of satellite communication space technologies. Thank you very much, and thank you very much for all the participants and my colleagues from IET. Thank you very much. So we will meet up again in one of these sessions in one of another interesting topics. So I wish all the best, Sanath, to for all your efforts at Arthur C. Clarke Institute, and we would like to see more and more achievements like Ravana 1. Maybe you may have plans Ravana 2, Ravana 3 or whatever. So we would like to see more and more achievements by Sri Lankans in the space technologies, space domain. So thank you very much. I wish everyone a good night and a happy weekend. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And slides and the recordings will be shared among all the registrations and participants.
Thank you, Lalit. It was a great pleasure. And also, I like the questions. I'm very glad that I was here. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We'll work together in future, Sanath.
Certainly.
Yeah.